Just wanted to give you guys a quick reminder, if you guys love my videos and want to support me, check out compassion-teas.com. Link is at the end of the video. All right, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you coming at you in January in my backyard garden. And today we're going to do your Q&As. We're going to answer your guys' questions that you may have for me. I apologize, there's one of me and I have over 550,000 subscribers now on my YouTube channel. So I'm unable to answer every question that comes in under videos or over different, you know, Instagrams or Facebooks or various methods. So I apologize for that. That being said, if you do want to talk to me and make sure you get an answer, you can sign up for a Fiverr where for just $5 plus small service fee, I will give you a call for 10 minutes and answer any questions to the best of my ability. A link is down below for that. And if you want your question in a video like this, make sure you check in the description down below for a link to my community tab where you can ask your question, and then every month I will make a Q&A video and answer your questions for you guys. So this is January's Q&A episode. All right. Oh, and then I do want to say all the money that comes in from Fiverr, it goes back out to the Fiverr community to help get my videos transcribed for people that are hearing impaired or are speak other languages. Once it is transcribed in English, Google will translate it into other languages. So thank you for those of you guys that have helped me with that mission to get my message of growing your own food and eating more healthy fruits and vegetables out to more people. All right, so on with today's question. First question is from Vegan Foot Soldier. Please talk about nutrient sources common in organic farming compared to conventional. Does organic use more animal inputs than conventional on average? This is at the heart of a debate in the vegan community right now, which says organic isn't vegan because of more animal input sources, yet I cannot see how this is true even on that level, ignoring all the other externalities and environmental concerns. All right. So I could say that, you know, it's hard to classify anything this or that. You know, I haven't visited too many huge commercial farms to kind of know that. Being said, I have gone to agricultural conferences and plenty of small farms, right? And here's the thing, right? Farming is a business, right? It's a business, straight up. And so in business, you want to maximize your profits and you want to minimize your expenditures, right? And so the fact of the matter is animal manure is cheap and or free in many cases, as is biosolids, which hopefully are not being used on, should not be used on organic crops, but could be used on conventional crops. You know, would somebody who's vegan feel more comfortable about using biosolids from the city of LA on their food, or slaughtered cows that are now deceased and their poop on their food, you know? I don't know. But so, you know, here's the thing, like if you're doing organic, there are only certain organic inputs that can be used to feed your crops. Plenty of them are plant source, right? You could use compost derived from plants, you know, the majority of the compost I use, maybe like a very small percent, is any kind of animal manure. I don't like that. I don't like using animal manures in my garden, but sometimes that comes along with something that I really want to add in my garden. But for the most part, all my compost is plant-based, and I would hope that most, you know, farms would use a plant-based compost. But, you know, plant-based compost can be more expensive than people just trying to get rid of their animal manure, which is a waste product. You know, that being said, my personal opinion is if a farm, organic farm, is using animal manure, is now the food grown with that, you know, waste product of a slaughterhouse or a chicken farm or wherever, not vegan? I mean, I think that's really ridiculous, because you could get so vegan that basically you're paralyzed and you don't do anything, because literally nothing is vegan. Even in organic farming, right, they're using pesticides that are killing bugs, and then that could be considered non-vegan. So I think the whole vegan message could get taken too far. Personally, I think really nothing is vegan, and in our world today, there's no true cultures that are vegan at all. You know, life is not vegan. Animals eat other animals, things get killed, and I understand that people want to do no harm or do less harm. And for those of you guys that are true hardcore vegans, the best thing you guys could do, in my opinion, is grow your own food. Grow a garden. Then you could control all the inputs that are going into your garden. You could control if you spray any organic pesticides when you have an outbreak, or you could come out and pick off each bug off the plant and put it over the neighbor's fence or relocate them to another field. You know, you guys could be as vegan as you'd want if you guys grow your own food, but as long as you're getting big agriculture, big industry to grow your own food, you are at their mercy. You don't know how your food is raised. You may not be truly vegan. There may be no such thing as true vegans, because even if you're eating vegan foods, it may not be grown in accordance with vegan rules, whatever they may be. You know, as far as I'm aware, being vegan is about, avoiding animal products as much as possible and practicable. And, you know, I think trying to, like, you know, buy food that's grown organically is doing better than conventional, because even if conventional is maybe vegan because they're using synthetic fertilizers not produced from animal manures, but then, you know, they're literally destroying the earth to rob nutrients from the earth to put these in bags in highly concentrated amounts, which then also the non-organic fertilizers imbalance the soil microbial community and will kill microbes, and that's why we have topsoil degradation, partly because of all the chemicals being used in the soil that are killing soil microbes. So even conventional food is not truly vegan, in my opinion, if you want to be concerned about it. So what I would say is that just eat more plant foods. You know, I believe personally organic overall in the scheme of things is better than others, but of course the best of all is what I'm doing. I'm just growing my own food, you know, and that's about all I have to say about that topic. I encourage all my viewers out there to eat more plants. Plants are much better for the environment. Plants are much better for your personal health. And I think the big problem today is people get on this whole, you're either vegan or you're not vegan. You know, people don't call me vegan because I eat some honey on rare occasion, you know, a couple times a year, you know, or I use some bug spray, you know, some organic pesticide to kill my aphids. I'm not vegan. I mean, I don't care what you guys want to call me. I like to say that, you know, the majority, overwhelming majority of my diet is fruits and vegetables. And I would encourage you guys to increase more of your fruits and vegetables, whether you want to put a label on that or not. I really don't care, but I want you guys to eat more fruits and vegetables. Vegan processed foods and, you know, are literally just junk foods. And yes, as long as you're saving the animals, that's great. But I see too many vegans just eat too much processed junk foods, which is no better than really eating non-vegan, in my opinion. So eat real food and eat as many fruits and vegetables as you could stuff in to displace all the other foods that you may be eating. And of course, grow as many of them as you possibly can yourself. All right, next question. Tanya Wells Matthews. Hello, I live in Las Vegas and I'm new to gardening. I'm also renting my house, so I'm interested in container gardens for now. What soil do I use here and how can I do this when my yard is 95% sunny? One corner gets shade and sun and I have it partially set up. I've spent many months watching videos, but I want to get started. I kill plants inside, but I grow sprouts real easily, regularly, LOL. Thank you, I've been a fan for years. All right, Tanya, so most of my garden, you know, especially this side, is you know, full sun in the summertime, and you know it's actually better to grow in full sun, especially in the wintertime. The wintertime right now, if you have full sun, is a blessing, because in the shade things are still really cold, and in the sun things are actually growing. So the best time to grow in Vegas is actually the wintertime, not the summertime. It's actually much easier, you know, and also because we have a, you know, hard freeze, 26 degrees the other night. The aphids that I did have on my greenhouse, I basically plucked the plants and put them outside. They froze, and so I don't have any pest issues, or very minimal pest issues in the wintertime as well. Just grow, you know, crops you can grow in the winter, like the kales, the collards, the onion family, the mustard greens. I grow some lettuces as well. Arugula grows really well. Bok choy. The arugula actually does quite well. But yeah, so grow in the winter, you're halfway missing the boat now. You could still start up as soon as possible. The other thing, growing in Vegas in containers can be quite challenging. I would recommend having the largest container as possible. Containers tend to dry out exceedingly fast in the summertime and can be really hard to grow in. You know, I had a video with the raised bed behind me. If I remember, I'll put a link down below. Also have built other, you know, containers, you know, like fabric pots you could use that are super big containers you could pick up and move, so you're not actually digging in the dirt. I would also recommend building raised beds on top of the soil. You could put pottoms on them if you want. I like to kind of leave them connected to the ground and basically just dig them all up when you leave your rental. I did have a video where I actually made a video with somebody who does rent. If I remember, I'll put a link down below to that so you guys can see what he did. And, you know, so largest container possible. Full sun is great. You just got to grow the right things in full sun. Some things won't make it. I haven't had the best luck of growing tomatoes in Vegas in full sun. Although, if you want to grow tomatoes, visit the tomato lady. Her tomatoes always look great in the full sun, and I have yet to totally figure out exactly what she's doing. I know she adds, you know, a special and fertilizes more regularly than I would normally. And then, just grow things that are tolerant. You know, so my Egyptian walking onions grow really great in the summer. The water spinach will grow great in the summer despite all the heat, direct intense heat. It just grows faster. Sweet potatoes, another thing that just really loves the heat. Eggplants, another thing that really loves the heat. Peppers tend to do generally a lot better than tomatoes, and I grow the small fruited varieties. Sweet banana peppers, definitely one of the best varieties. And just watch my videos and see which plants grow really well for me and in full sun, and try those as well. Malabar spinach is another one that grows really well. And I think the main thing about growing in Vegas is just selecting the right plants, all right? And then let's see, what soil do you use here? And so then I guess the best place that I've found so far that I'm not completely entirely happy with is Vera Grow in North Vegas. I got the tomato lady mix, which I would not get anymore at this time. When I got my soil mix, they didn't have actually any, organic mixes. Now they do. That being said, the organic mixes of organic soil, to me, look like they need to be broken down more. So I'd buy their mixes, let it sit around for a year or two, let it continue to compost and break down, and then use it. Or if you get their mix, you know, I would screen it out some and take a lot of the woody chunks out before using it. Although, of course, the woody chunks may have a benefit, because they also may retain water. That's the best I could say. I mean, I brought in a lot of soil from outside. Some of the soil I brought in actually was from bag soil from Dr. Earth. That can get quite expensive, but I guess it depends how big your garden is. The orange pot of gold soil, is definitely really good. And actually, I would recommend that for container plants, but it is actually also quite expensive. All right, next question is from Tara Hud 1024. I have a huge slug problem every year during the spring. What have you seen over the years that works best? Well, you know, my personal opinion is that for slugs, what works best is you. You work best for slugs. Go out there with a headlamp and pick them all off one by one. You got to do this like every single night, and you will decrease their populations. Also, look for their eggs, which look like little round, clear balls, which, when you find them, you got to dispose of them. I mean, I think that's the best solution, and then I would couple picking them off at night, every night, with something like a Sluggo product, which is certified OMRI for use in organic agriculture, although some people say, they're not as good as they say or not as organic. That being said, it is not harmful to dogs and pets and other things, so I would use it in limited areas. And I think by picking them off and using the Sluggo product, you could be successful to reduce the slug population significantly. Apuzz 13. Not sure if this is truly a gardening question, but you did a video on the Aerogarden, and I was wondering if you still think it's a good idea for people with limited time and brown thumb. Yeah, so the Aerogarden, so it's the small kitchen garden that you could grow just maybe 6 plants in or something like that, and it is what it is, right? It's good because it'll allow you to grow your own food. And I think any way you guys could grow your own food is definitely better. Before I bought an Aerogarden, which could be like $100, some of them maybe you might find for $50, it'd be a lot better to invest in growing your own microgreens or even just sprouts, and doing that on a regular continual basis. I think that's much more valuable and actually a lot more cost effective than buying an Aerogarden, which will grow like 6 plants. And if you grow basil, you could have year-round basil, you could keep cutting it back and eating more basil, which I think is great, but I think it's kind of a waste of space to grow like little cherry tomatoes or something indoors. It's kind of more like a novelty item. I think the best use of the Aerogarden, or growing lettuce inside under an Aerogarden, it just takes a long time for a little bit of lettuce. I mean, things do grow faster in the Aerogarden, though. I think the best use of the Aerogarden is for herbs, but I think your best use is actually growing sprouts or microgreens. So be sure to check my other videos on the sprouts and the microgreens. They're a lot easier to grow, a lot sooner time to harvest, and they're a lot more nutritionally dense for people to eat, all right? Scott Winiger. This is Scott and Tina. We are wondering if you and your girlfriend are still together. We have not been able to watch for about a year. Scott, Lauren and I are broken up. We are no longer boyfriend and girlfriend. I'm single now, and I've noticed just being single, Things take a little bit more time because I used to have help with some things around the house and whatnot, and now it's just basically all me. And so now I even have less time than I did previously, all right? We are still friends, though, all right? Okay, next question is Anthony MacArthur. I have a garden spot 8 by 120 feet. The weeds are horrible. I've used straw to keep for a year to keep them at bay. Last year I didn't use anything and tried to hand pull the weeds. Failure. I've had 2 more garden spots and not enough time. Chemicals are out of the question. So we have 200 acres to collect leaves from the woods. The leaves have the white stringy fungi everyone talks about. In the 8 by 121 foot, I put one thick of those collected leaves. I put down a layer of sawdust on top, no tilling. This area has been tilled 3 times last year. Will this be okay? I have no idea. That's my honest opinion. So what I recommend for doing for weeds in your situation where you have like a big garden area for weed that are totally weedy, I would recommend solarizing. So get some like thick black plastic, as thick as you guys could get. Maybe like an old pond liner would work well. I've seen various things used, big tarps or big banners, and just spread that over the ground and put rocks on them and make sure all the seams are overlapping so no sun can get to the ground. The sun will hit it when it warms up, and basically it'll just heat up the ground, kill all the weed seeds, kill everything back. So basically you're starting with a clean slate, because as long as you have weed seeds and as long as you have active roots down there, you will not get ahead, right? The other thing I would do after you pull up all that, the solarization, after you leave that sitting down for a good period of time, I would then cardboard sheet mulch. So I'd put cardboard down and then lay all your leaves and all your good stuff on top of it and let that break down over time. And this will give the soil enough time to basically regenerate and then start planting, you know, other beneficial crops that you actually would like there. In its place to take place of what has been grown there in the past. In this way, I think you guys could get a handle on your weeds. I mean, if it was me, what I would do is I would personally just, I'd personally probably just sheet mulch it all with a couple layers of cardboard, and then I'd build raised beds over it and then bring in soil and grow in the raised beds. That's what I'd probably do personally. But, you know, if you have a large area, was it 8 by 120 feet? I guess you could probably make 2 large raised beds, but if you want to grow on the ground, that's a little bit different story, all right? So that's what I do. I hope that helps, all right? The Wick Lund 25. I've learned recently that aphids are attracted to overburden of nitrogen. How do you control this without sacrificing essential plant health? So, I mean, in my belief, nitrogen is just way overused in standard vegetable gardening and in gardening practices. And it is just focused on too much, right? As much as plant needs nitrogen, which is, you know, a major growth nutrient to grow big crops, you know, there's plenty of other nutrients that are in the soil or should be in the soil that plants need as well for their health that, you know, activate all these different enzyme pathways and all these crazy things that I don't really even know about. And so I would say, you know, don't add high nitrogen fertilizers, right? High nitrogen fertilizers above like 10 are usually synthetic, you know, and that's basically using an alchemical model where you're basically just feeding the plants the nitrogen directly through a water-soluble source, which also tends to pollute. You know, if you use nitrogen in natural ratios, like for example in compost that contain a lot of other different minerals as well as microbes, and you also add in rock dust and kelp and seaweed powders and ocean solid minerals, right? Your plants are gonna be more well balanced, and they're gonna have all the different minerals, also the more importantly the organic matter, and also more importantly the microbes, right? And when you have enough organic matter, microbes, and minerals, guess what? Your plants do great. The microbes basically will digest and solubilize the minerals and the organic matter and make those available for the plants, right? And that's how things work. You know, I know, in some of the conventional strawberry fields in California, they have been doing testing with using microbes to basically reduce insect populations and increasing the fertility and having a more balanced soil and actually higher quality soil that will produce more sugars in the plant, which are more complex and aphids cannot, digest. So part of the reason why the overburden of nitrogen basically makes weak plants, which make easily digestible food for aphids. And if you have higher quality plants with higher Brix values, you know, the bugs will avoid them because they cannot digest these more complex proteins, which are actually better for us because that means there's more protein in the food for us because everybody likes to focus on protein, you know, in human diets. That being said, more important to me than protein are antioxidants and phytonutrients, which guess what? Also, when you're growing in a natural way, are also going to be more higher, you know, than when using synthetics or chemical fertilizers as well. So hope that answers your question. You know, for me, I don't really try to look at nitrogen fertilizer too much. I try to have a nice balance of good compost, as well as the worm castings, the rock dust, all the microbes, because they'll basically make it happen for you guys if you have a, you know, a good starting base. All right. Let's see, Robert Medeiros. Hey John, been a big fan of your videos for a while since moving from Boston to San Diego. I was wondering how or where I can buy Malabar spinach or tree collards. Both seem interesting to grow. Thanks. All right, Robert. So glad you're in San Diego now. Much warmer climate to grow in than Boston. And so let's see. Oh, so tree collards and Malabar spinach can both be had by taking a trip up to Norwalk, California to CPG Nursery during the right time of year. They don't always have the tree collards or the Malabar spinach, but in the right season, they will have them. You can call them up to check their availability, or they have availability PDFs available online. And then the other thing, if you that's the most affordable one, and I would recommend going there and just stocking up on their plants. They have some of the best plants that I like to buy on a regular basis and grow in my garden. And actually, most of the plants you guys see behind me are from CPG. Aside from that, if you don't want to drive that far to Norwalk, which could be maybe 2 hours or an hour, depending on where in San Diego you live, then I would go to Pearson's Gardens in Vista, California. Unfortunately, Pearson's does not allow me to film videos there. I love that place because they have so many different, you know, unique and exotic and rare perennial vegetables, especially. For some reason, they don't want me to film. I've asked them several occasions. And the other thing I've noticed actually over the years, their selection has dwindled. It's getting a little bit smaller, so I don't know if they have staffing changes or different things have changed there. And also I noticed their prices have increased, so they're actually quite expensive, but they do have some rare, cool stuff that if you really look hard enough can be available other places, but I do still like them despite their high prices, although I do not buy any large quantities there at any time. So yeah, check that place out. They should also have those specialty crops. Next question is Aaron Quick. Hey, really big fan of your YouTube channel. I was wondering if what your thoughts were on the best alkaline foods you grow and where I might find seeds as well. Thanks. All right, so I mean, best alkaline foods without, you know, looking them up are deep green leafy vegetables. Deep green leafy vegetables. Which ones? I don't know. Is spinach more alkalizing than kale? Than, you know, I don't know, chard? I don't know, man. Grow variety and eat them all is what I like to do. So I have, you know, like cabbages and spinach right there, and I have tatsoi there. I have, you know, like beet greens there. I mean, I have all different kinds of parsley growing, cilantro growing, all different kinds of stuff. So I can't really say what food is more alkalinizing. I think it's more important that you eat alkalinizing foods such as leafy greens. My goal every day is to eat 2 pounds of leafy greens. You know, that's my goal. I'm not going to say I meet that goal every day. I usually get a pound of greens in me every day, though. And, you know, the other thing I want to say is that you want to stop eating the foods that are causing acidity in the body. You know, coffee, processed foods, junk foods, animal foods. Too many of those foods will make your body over-acid. And the acid-alkaline balance is just one aspect of health. You know, that being said, a healthy diet is an alkaline diet, in my opinion, overall. So, you know, plant foods, for the most part, there are exceptions, are alkaline foods. And of course, the leafy greens are the king of the alkaline foods. Actually, I like to grow the tree collards because they're quite easy. I have almost tree collards in almost every bed now as the over story in the center. And I grow other crops around them. Actually, I kind of like the one right there is a nice, really nice specimen. He's grown really good. But yeah, so grow more leafy greens. Where to get the seeds? You know, I don't know. Check out Baker Creek Heirloom Seed Company. They're just like an easy go-to place. They have lots of different varieties of greens. I mean, Johnny's Seeds, another place I like to use a lot. You know, they have more affordable prices. You know, and especially, when I like to just broadcast. Sometimes I just like to buy seeds in bulk and just broadcast them and see what comes up, you know. And this depends on the time of year. I like to just broadcast like Claytonia or the Miner's Lettuce and just see what comes up, you know. You know, dandelions, you know, another thing that could get quite weedy, but, you know, another leafy green you guys should be growing. So, yeah, all the different greens, I wouldn't say this one or that one's better than others. You know, grow the ones that are easiest for you so you actually will grow them and actually grow what you like to eat. You know, that's more important than growing. John said to grow this variety because it's alkaline, but then you hate the taste. You know, like New Zealand spinach, it grows so easy, but I just don't like it. It's too oxalic-y for me, and I just rarely ever eat it. And so if I told you to grow that and you hated it, it would be no use, right? So grow what you like to eat, right? All right? Next question is from iBooby8. Does yacon make you gassy like Sunchokes? So in my experience, no, completely not. I could drink like a whole glass of yacon juice, which actually tastes amazing, and I have no ill results when I drank a glass or more of Sunchoke juice. I was on the toilet, like, straight. So it doesn't have quite as much the inulin or undigestible fibers that we cannot digest, based on my personal experience, all right? All right, next question from Brian Riley. What advice would you offer for a complete novice looking into growing their own food, all right? So what I would say for the complete novice is get started, right? Try to find the best soil you could buy and get plant starts, which are easier to grow than seeds for the first-time gardener. And put in an irrigation system, you know, super important because you will forget to water. You won't water enough, and try to get it all dialed in properly. I have plenty of videos, you know, sharing with you guys how to set up a raised bed garden. If I remember, I'll put a link down below to one I did in Texas where I was actually setting up my girlfriend's, because that was my ex-girlfriend, her roommate with a garden. And actually that was a really nice video where I go through the whole entire process and I explain a lot of things. I'd also encourage you guys to watch some of my videos, right? And my videos are a wealth of knowledge. I have long format videos, which is good and bad, because I basically share a lot of information that, you know, you're not going to get in a 5-minute video where, you know, they're not, you can't explain totally everything. And I really strive to have you guys like have an understanding of gardening and not just like, oh, do this and you could be fine, right? And so I don't know, hopefully that has you know, come out in my videos. And that's all I pretty much say. The other thing I'd say actually is I would encourage you to start with growing sprouts and microgreens, especially in the wintertime. I don't know where you live, but you know, get really good at growing sprouts and microgreens, and that will make you a better successful gardener, because then you'll have the power to be able to successfully grow and start your own seeds and germinate your own seeds successfully, and then you'll be able to grow them into bigger plants, all right? Last question actually today is from Nathan Guest. Hi there, hope you're well. I would like to know your thoughts and experiences on growing in the same place year after year. Thank you, love your work, and keep it up. All right, so growing in the same place every year, I mean, I know this is shunned upon in many gardening books, and it's like you should always rotate your crops, and, you know, some books even have like, you gotta rotate your roots to your leafy greens to your fruits and then your roots again, and don't grow the same thing because of nutrient depletion and all this kind of stuff. And so this is my personal take on it, right? I mean, number one, you have nutrients being depleted in the soil. That could be completely true, and it's true that some plants may pull certain nutrients than others. That's completely true. The other issue that there is that there could be pests. So if I grow tomatoes in a bed, you know, there may be hornworms in that bed because of the prior year, and then the hornworms will lay their eggs or larvae or whatever in the bed, and then they'll hatch next year, and then they'll have their tomatoes to eat the following year. So for pest reasons, I do like to rotate my beds, you know, in a small, you know, urban environment where I have limited raised beds and I can't swap them out or, you know, grow different things as much as I'd like. Do I repeat the same bed sometimes? Yes, absolutely. Do I try to grow like at least a different plant family? You know, if I grew this one in like lettuce this year, I'm gonna try to plant, you know, onions next year. And if I grew, you know, kale over here, then the following season, I'm gonna try to switch that out to peppers, you know, or the following year, I'm gonna try to do lettuce. So I try to do that to the best of my ability, but sometimes, you know, while that isn't important to me, there's other factors that are more important, especially in the wintertime when, you know, my garden gets shaded by my house. You know, what's more important to me is, like, I know certain beds get more sun, and the plants that I really want to thrive will get planted in those beds, and depending on what plants I have and, you know, what garden beds are empty or I need to flip and replant, those are what gets planted out. So I try to take into consideration, you know, planting something different every season. Does that always happen? Absolutely not. Not if I had like 20 acres, would I ever plant the same thing, the same space again, unless it was a perennial? Probably not. But on a small scale, you know, I'm not really worried too much. And if pest outbreaks occur, I deal with them. Now, the nutrient depletion, maybe on large-scale agriculture where you're not paying as close of attention to the nutrition of your soil, you know, I could see that could be like a, you know, a big kind of belief and probably a good belief to follow. And so if you, there's a lot of principles that have trickled down from big farming to gardens that gardeners like to do. And, you know, in my situation where I actually really build a really fertile soil mix and continually add nutrients to my soil and add microbes through over the growing season to the soil and have trace minerals in there, my personal belief is that I have enough nutrients to grow the plants, you know, provide their leafy greens. Now, if they're fruiting crops, then I like to definitely supplement, especially in the hot sun here. But in general, I believe that by adding and topping off your beds every year with a good, you know, mixture of compost, worm castings, rock dust, and all the things I add in, you should be fine to grow in the same place year after year. That being said, these are my opinions, and I would encourage you guys always to experiment, you know. Experiment with growing things year after year in the same bed or, you know, flip into a new bed. I always encourage you guys actually to try to flip things and not grow things in the same place, but sometimes it's just not avoidable, and personally, I wouldn't really worry about it too much. And if you're really concerned, you know, hey, hit your plants with some extra, you know, organic, you know, nutrients like kelp or fish or whatever, you know, to give them a little bit of a boost to help the soil out, and also, you know, hit them with some compost tea, right? Because as long as you have compost in the raised bed that you're growing in, that's a lot of unlocked nutrition for your plants. If you get the microbes in there, they start unlocking that nutrition, making it available for the plants, and then you can continue the cycle. So, you know, the whole kind of rotation is kind of based on a more alchemical growing model, in my opinion, you know, because in nature does not really rotate. I mean, nature, things will grow in the same place, the plants will grow, they'll drop seeds, a lot of them will grow in the same place year after year. Have you ever thought about that? So yeah, that's pretty much the end of this Q&A for today. If you guys enjoyed this Q&A session, want more, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also, be sure to share this video with some of you think it might help. And be sure so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes. They're coming out every 3 to 4 days. To click that subscribe button right down below. Make sure you click the bell so you get notification when my new videos come out. You never know what you'll be learning or what you might be missing in one of my videos. Also, be sure to check out past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,400 videos at this time. Teach you guys all aspects on how to grow your own food at home and become more self-sufficient and become healthier by eating the foods you are growing. And with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.